Lucy, what are you doing with my Comic-Con badge? You know, I don't think they allow cats at Comic-Con. Hey, oh, mine. Mine? Lucy, let go of it. Lucy? That's a good girl. Sorry, but I cannot take you to Comic-Con. What are you doing, Lucy? You know I want to take a shower. You know, first you steal my badge, and now you're hijacking my shower. What am I going to do with you? Are you just riding about? Seriously, what am I going to do with you, Lucy? You know, it's times like these where I'm a little bummed that they don't allow cameras at the Q&As anymore, because I'm seeing these three guys all on Friday, and then seeing this guy, old childhood memory, on Saturday. And I'll tell you, that panel actually, you had to buy your tickets in advance. So now we're on the main floor where they have all the booths and concessions. They have everything from t-shirts to costumes, comic books, bunch of collectibles. I think I even saw a tattoo parlor here. Not that I'm going to get one. But also see a lot of cosplayers here as well. Yeah, it's a bit of a madhouse right now. Still not sure how many people are here at the convention. Maybe I'll pick up a shirt or two, I don't know yet. Nice little lightsaber display there. Can't get myself a new hat. Quite a collection. Okay, they got some comic books. Don't really read them. So I did win a couple years ago. I think they were the Akira comics. They're still in the packaging. Haven't really touched them. Mystery boxes. I think I've seen a few friends of mine on YouTube with these. Got just about anything in there. There even more comic books here. I So what used to be the gaming hall for the past 3 years for video games has now gone to the way of the trading card games, more specifically Magic the Gathering and Pokemon. So there are going to be a bunch of tournaments here. I'm probably going to participate in one or two of them to see how that goes. They also turned this lobby into a little makeshift store where they're selling a bunch of trading cards, and it looks like they got a bunch of board games over here as well. Pretty extensive collection here. I haven't played Ticket to Ride yet. I'm probably going to try that out later on. I think I saw Settlers of Catan in here somewhere. Yep, right there. Really the game that kind of got me into board gaming. And of course we got Red Dragon in, one of my favorites. 39%. Even got the 5th edition, which it looks like it has all the characters, I think.
It stays right here. That POS will stay back here.
The mobile POS sits there.
No movie. It's almost like Imperial Outpost all just came here and started selling stuff.
I know.
So this is where they're having the gaming events this year. They have retro gamers on this side and modern gamers on this one. So I'm going to check out both of them. You know you're getting old when GameCube is in the retro gaming section. Oh, look at this. It's a Game Boy. Now we are in the modern gaming section. Let's see what they got here. This looks like Wii and Wii U.
To Tiffany's company as an artist for many of her games.
My name is Trish Stedman. I am part of Magic People Games. I co-own it with my husband Ian here. We are a board game publisher, and we also organize and run all of Phoenix Comicon's gaming that does not include electronic gaming. So if it's RPGs, tabletops, card games, that's all under my banner.
And that's all on the second floor of the Hyatt.
By the elevators.
Check it out. There's a lot over there. My name is Ian Stedman. I am the co-owner and chief creative officer for Magic People Games. I wear all the hats that I don't have the time or resources to hire someone else for, which includes pretty much everything. Design, development, marketing, sometimes illustration, lots of graphic design. Yeah, that's what I do. I make games.
Which is exactly why there are so many different roles within the gaming community. A lot of them are really compartmentalized, where you would have six different roles and people that are necessary to create one game. I know a lot of people have the idea of their game, the thing that they want to make, but you're not going to make it alone. You're going to have other people on board. I know I've worked with at least a dozen other people for every one of my games. I primarily start with the design and move into the designing aspects of the games, but there are certainly plenty of things I cannot do myself, and that's why we're talking about the different careers. So I personally start with the design aspect of a game and what I want a game to do, what I want it to look like, how I want it to run, but other components of that are, once I script this thing, I need somebody else, a third party, to review it, make sure that it looks good enough to spend money on the artwork. And that's something that Jeff has more experience with.
Right. So one of the things that can be career paths for you in tabletop gaming is you've got to be able to design different elements. Playing cards are one of the ones that I have most experience with. You have to make sure the information is legible, readable, very quick, and easy to understand, and be able to lay out, as well as board game elements, any other elements that you're going to need in the game. And somebody who has a good eye for design needs to be able to work with the game designer, be able to understand their vision and where they want them to go, and be able to do that.
Well, you can do individual components of the artwork, and then you can also do the graphic design. Sometimes the same person does both components, but not necessarily.
And so there is a distinct difference between somebody who's creating the art that is going to create the story or the mood or the general feel for the game, and then you have somebody who's going to create the mechanical game, stuff that is going to convey the gameplay. The graphic artist needs to support the gameplay at all times. Gameplay is the most important feature of this. So you do have two different types of artists who are going to be able to do this. Then you have somebody who has to kind of wrangle the cats. This could be your art coordinator, your art director, whoever you want to call this. This person has to have an overall view and vision of what this game is going to be, where it's going, and what is trying to be communicated through the story, because all we've got are pictures. We're not going to be able to read you the story as to what's going on. Battlegrounds is a great example here. We have this world that's instantly conveyed to you by these small little creatures, these garden gnomes, who apparently are very upset at each other. Why is that? You have to play the game to find out. Then we also have artists who are doing production for the business end. These are four different hats here, but sometimes it's worn by the same person. Somebody has to do ads, somebody has to do box art, somebody has to do flyers, somebody has to do business cards. So these rule book illustrations, there's actually two different subsets right there. Somebody who does covers and does rulebook covers is probably going to be a different person than who does the illustrations inside the rulebook itself. So these are different paths that you can go into gaming as different careers.
And just an example of that is, for Battle Gnomes, I actually had four different types of artists. One was for the gnomes themselves, another was for all of the other artwork in the game, and a third was for the graphic design of it, which is different than the inside interior artwork, and then a fourth was for all my promotional work. So you can take on any one of these artistic talents. You can take on several, wear multiple hats. What about Magic Meeple Games? Do you have any experience similar to that?
Experience in hiring artists, or?
And the different types of artists that you might use, and the different kinds of people you work with.
Yeah, Fire Revital on is a really good example. This game had two different artists. One artist for the full resolution cover art that you see here, and then another artist for all of the game components, which are all scaled down to a 16-bit style, like a Super Nintendo game. So I had to do the art direction to get those ideas coherent, so what one artist was doing didn't look so dramatically out of the park from what the other one was delivering. And it came together really, really well.
We had two graphic designers as well.
We did have two graphic designers on this one. I was one of them, and Mary Turton did the rest of it. And being able to sit side by side with one person to say, oh, you know, this is what the vision is, this is what it is sort of like, we need to have these things to be consistent across the entire product, start to pitch. Very, very important.
And there are a variety of ways to do that. You can certainly hire a company. You can also hire individuals. Sometimes you do have a lot more people to wrangle than you necessarily anticipated. How has Magic Meeple Games kind of dealt with that component for themselves?
We do all of our marketing ourselves. We go to a lot of panels to learn more about social media marketing and things like that. There is a lot of good content, Gamma I saw, about these kinds of things. And to be perfectly honest, it's something I need a lot more help with because it's too much for one person to do.
Yeah.
But Facebook, Instagram, Twitter are the big three that we focus on, and BoardGameGeek above all else. If you're looking to have a game out in the public, in eyes, in any way whatsoever, get it listed on BoardGameGeek.
It's a free listing.
Yeah,
it just
totally
needs
free.
To be approved.
So I actually have somebody that is a super fan of my games, just loves my games, but I don't have it in my budget to pay them right now. So of her own volition, she actually does a lot of the social media stuff, and I appreciate that. I never offer somebody, hey, you know, you'll get exposure. If I'm gonna do something for somebody, I'm gonna pay them. But of course, she's just doing it. She knows that. But the moment I have that budget, I'm hiring this person. You know, it's definitely a foot in the door. And the moment I have the opportunity, I'm gonna do something where I can pay for more critical projects, for bigger projects. Not just because she's shown that she's interested in being part of the company at that level. And that's actually another component of it, is how you would get your foot in the door, how you get involved in game companies to begin with, how you get hired on, or how you get the contracts. There's certainly a variety of ways to do it. I know people who have just stepped up, who later got a job from me, a contracted position, because they stepped up at one point and said, hey, I'm interested in what you have. You know, and in this situation with her, you know, she has done a lot of that for me, and I'm trying to figure out how to make that work more on an official level.
Everyone that does a favor for me and helps me out at least gets copies of the game. You know,
that's right, well, that's definitely something. You definitely get copies of the game, and yeah, I definitely try to reward you.
Slaying
I just
goodies and, yeah, that's
in the marketing field, and this is across all aspects. But any social media marketing, there's a big trend for community managers.
Yes.
Managing, like Yelp has community managers. Different companies, I've seen community managers, like Tasty Minstrel Games has a community manager.
Undead Viking,
right.
Anyone's familiar with this channel, he's now the community manager for Tasty Minstrel.
Yeah. And interacting with the people on social media, that's huge. You can sit there and you can post all day long, and if I'm sitting here on Facebook, you know, at 11 o'clock in the bathroom, because let's be honest, Facebook bathroom, right? See, you know. I'm going, okay, this is nice. I might ask a question, maybe, if I see something, but are they going to answer me? And that's where a community manager comes in. Interacting with your backers, interacting with your followers, interacting with the people that need to talk to you. So that is a huge career path, and it's absolutely legit.
The Dark Art Adventures campaign ended 2 years ago, and I'm still fielding questions from people and talking to the community for that Kickstarter. So that's like, that's a long-term investment. I mean, even if the Kickstarter's over, you still gotta have someone interacting with that community.
I really thought that the easiest part of starting the game company would be interacting with people on social media, because I like Facebook.
Well, that's actually
it's pretty overwhelming. Did you have a question?
Yeah, along with the social media stuff marketing, do you need a website as well?
I would highly recommend it.
Those
That's another career that a person, you know, can look at is website management or maintenance or developers. Or even artwork. I did have somebody do all my infographics. That was the fourth artist, Trip Battle, that was doing all my infographics. So yeah, that's definitely another career path for people, or at least a way to be contracted into a gaming company.
Oh god! Oh god! Oh god! Oh! Here, shotgun, I got pasta ready for you.
Joestar in the station two? Joseph Joestar in the station two?
Hopefully he'll figure it out.
And then he'll just come
Jonathan Gutierrez to station 3. Kiva and Jonathan to station 3.
Outside of Arizona, so with Twitch, it's amazing to be able to play for people in Germany, UK, all over the world, really. So yeah, it's a lot of fun. I recommend it to anybody who plays guitar and sings, and you know, just give it a try. You never know what you can do with it.
So now we're gonna go over and turn to Camille.
Oh, Camille is a creative streamer here in Arizona. She goes by Rin the Yordle, which I'm sure she'll tell you why. And she actually has a vendor hall downstairs too, which she's going to talk about, I'm sure.
Okay, I mean, again, sure. So, hi, I'm known as Rin. I do a lot of creative stuff, much like this cool dude over here, which again, I actually started off well before creative was even implemented, and we were like hiding in the background, like, hey, we still play video games, but actually. And then they opened up creative, which was actually really awesome. So any of you who are doing cooking, art, you name it, anything that's cool that things you think might be fun to broadcast, do it. Board games, anything. They have a lot of really cool stuff, so do it. It's really, really cool. That aside, I stream a lot of my artwork. I do a lot of League of Legends-based stuff, hence the Yordle end of the part of it. So I'm known for my character based on that. I've been featured with League of Legends quite a few times now. And yeah, now I just do a lot of my streaming and play games on the side as well. So like my fails at Breath of the Wild, you know how many times I die, my stream's been having fun keeping up with that one. I had a death counter, so they made sure that I had a death counter for that one. So I was doing good for a while, and then it slowly went down. So. But yeah, if anybody would like to see some of my artwork, I do have a booth along with one of my other artist buddies, Ippis, at 629 in the Vendors Hall, if anybody wants to see some of our stuff there. I have a lot of Overwatch, if anybody's into that, and a little bit of League stuff still left over, too, but it's going to ask them right now. Anyway, thanks!
Yeah,
her energy is literally probably one of my favorite things. She's usually like an energizer.
I don't need that. I'm loud enough as is. I feel weird with the mic in my face. Next we got Sam Hall. He's actually a competitive streamer. He does esports, he plays Call of Duty, CSGO, and is super huge in the Twitch community and has been around since the dawn of time with Twitch practically. And go ahead.
Yeah, so I used to compete in Call of Duty for many years, and I was actually able to go pro through Major League Gaming in 2011. And I was able to kind of transform that sort of like fan base I sort of had on Twitter and push it towards my stream. I started streaming because I wanted to get a job in esports. I always liked esports and gaming, obviously, the competitive side of things. So I wanted to start streaming, maybe get a sponsor here and there, maybe network with them, maybe try and work for them. Because back when I started, there was no really money in streaming. This was basically kind of just a hobby. So I started there, and one day I realized that, you know, maybe I actually can turn it into a job. I was getting more viewers and doing really, really well in Black Ops 2 when I was streaming that. And it's been a long ride. I've streamed a lot of games since then. I've done Counter-Strike, H1Z1, Ori the Blind Forest, Destiny. I've been around for 5 years. So a lot of games over that span. But yeah, it's awesome to see where Twitch has come and just continues to go. And if you guys haven't already, you'll definitely check it out, obviously. But yeah, esports is booming like crazy on Twitch. And I'm happy to be a part of that for sure.
And last we have Lindsay Elise, representing cosplayer streamer who has both used Twitch as a platform for both her creative and also kind of just watching herself in general. By the way, your outfit looks great today. Fantastic bucky. I would bet Arizona's hot today. It was
really cool. Bad idea. Hello, I'm Lindsay Elise. I started off as a cosplayer actually when I was about 14. And I did that for a long time and I loved it and I still love it. But about 4 years ago, I think, I was introduced to Twitch, and I kind of started so that I had a new way to engage with some of my followers, you know, because you can post a comment on a picture, but that's not the same thing as actually getting to talk to a person. So I was like, okay, well, I play games all the time, so let's try this out. Like, I'll start streaming, I'll talk to people around the world, it'll be awesome. And so I did that for a while. Just games for a while. And then when creative was announced, I was like, hey, I'm creative, I can do this stuff. Like, let me try to make costumes while I stream. And so my whole arm here, I made on stream. So it was kind of cool because everyone can see the start of the costume and they can watch you make it and learn, you know, if they want to do it themselves as well. So I've been doing a lot of creative streams lately. I'm also a member of CounterLogic Gaming. I am on their stream team, and that has been a dream come true. That was like the craziest email I've ever gotten. I've like never been that excited in my life, but that's been totally insane, and I've had the privilege of going to events with them and helping out with promotions and meeting all the pros, and I'm not a pro, but I can pretend. So.
Take it till you make it?
Yep.
And I guess on the topic of cosplay and kind of creating stuff on stream, it leads me to a question of, I'm sure some folks here are interested in what kind of tools do you guys use on stream, what makes your stream different compared to other people, what's special about your stream that you need to do your job, essentially. So,
yeah. My whole bedroom is, it's like 3/4 stream equipment. And then I have a cosplay room, and then my husband streams as well, and he has a game room as well. So pretty much our entire house is dedicated to streaming. I am a fan of green screens, so I have a giant green screen in the middle of my bedroom, which is a great place to put that. I have a 2-PC setup, so I stream on one PC and I game on another PC, which has been really helpful. As far as cosplay goes, I have a 3D printer, so this arm's actually 3D printed, and I have a separate camera set up on my printer so that people can watch it print, and then, you know, I take it off and I finish it, and I feel like 3D printing is still really new in the cosplay world, so people have been super interested in watching the process of, you know, putting something from the computer into the printer and then having a finished product, so that's been a lot of fun.
I actually have a question on that real quick.
Yeah.
Do you also stream the 3D modeling process as well?
No, because I can't do that.
Oh, okay. No, that's cool. That's cool. I want to get back into 3D modeling. That's why I was like, oh, that's cool. I want to watch that. Like,
yeah. No, I, there's some wonderful human beings out there who do all the modeling,
no,
and they just put the files out there for anyone to use.
That's awesome.
That's what I do. I'm like, there's a file for that. I guess that's my next cosplay. I have no modeling experience whatsoever.
Multiple embarrassing things.
Whatever you
want to
say.
So there was a bar toilet on the bar. Somebody else can take this.
Come on. Yeah,
so I my stream had to like clip this, and they have it broadcasted for forever. There's two different things. One that happened recently on Breath of the Wild, which was pretty hilarious, and the other one was a while ago on my older rig and stuff like that. But I was trying to stream a game. And in the process of it, I had one of those mosquito eaters fly into my room. Like the big ones that look like mosquitoes, but they're like this big. And it flew into my face. And I freaked out on stream. I was like, Rah! I like ran away from it, freaking everything. My game's still playing in the background. You see the monster shooting at me, but nothing's happening. I'm chasing it down with a shoe in the background. And still there to taunt me for forever. It's just like my character flipping my desk up. And then the other time I shrieked so loud because who knows of, like, I'm sure a lot of you know Breath of the Wild right now, where the lightning keeps striking down and everybody has their own freak out moment. Yeah, I had my freak out moment where I screamed as loud as I possibly could. Like, I was dancing around though. I'm like hopping with Link. I'm like, yay! Because, shoot, what's the bluebird's name again? I'm forgetting it right now. Cass, thank you. Cass is in there playing his thing, and I'm like, yeah, woohoo! And then the lightning strikes right on top of us, and I'm like, what? So, yeah, I have minor freakouts every once in a while. There's my embarrassing.
Actually, so I do IRL streaming as well from my live gigs, and yesterday, this actually happened last night, and I don't think anybody really caught it, but I asked for a Coke, and... Right. Well, now you guys can look for it. I asked for a Coke, and it was like the Coke in like the classic glass bottle, you know, the Coca-Cola. So I tried to do like a little advertisement for Coke right before I started singing. So I was like, there's nothing more refreshing than an ice cold Coke. And I went to go take a drink, and just like, I coughed it up, and yeah, I just kind of started playing my guitar again. So look for that.
Act cool. Nothing to see.
Yeah, yeah. My problem is, I go, you guys didn't see that, did you? And then they look.
I think we're in like 2 minutes or so.
Oh, come on.
I can only think of one really embarrassing thing. But I had a friend named Christy. She's also a broadcaster on Twitch. And we used to just mess around, like just like tease each other and stuff. She came to my stream one night. and was just messing around, like, hey, why didn't you call me last night? Like, you're supposed to go out, and, like, I never met her and all that kind of stuff, but she was messing with me in the chat, just trying to get me going. And the next morning, I get a text from my mom, and she says, hey, watch your stream last night for the first time, but who's Chrissy? And I was like, okay, what? Yeah, that's interesting. And then my dad watched my stream as well, and apparently to him, I'm going to be the next Howard Stern, so.
Now, what do we have here? The Game On Expo at the Convention Center, August 11th and 12th, 2017. Arizona's largest gaming convention. I think I have found my next adventure.